Hello, my dears. Welcome to my new location, which is my childhood bedroom, because I'm fancy and cool. My neighbors are doing construction for some reason, so if you hear weird noises, that's what that is. Also, there are birds around in the woods, and they're making noises, so you get some ambiance. But anyway, did you know that I can smell sound? Because I smell sound. And yes, I've always been this way. No, not every sound. No, I will not tell you what your name smells like. And yes, this is normal because I have synesthesia. So synesthesia is defined as the atypical connection between two senses or stimuli, such as smelling sound or numbers having gender. And it's estimated that 1 in 5 autistics have synesthesia in comparison to about 1 in 25 in the general population. And we can explain scientifically why this is. We talked in my first video about how the autistic brain is formed, but for those of you who are new here, or if you've just forgotten, we're going to go over it again. So the most widely accepted cause of autism, or rather how the autistic brain is formed, is by slowed apoptosis, or natural cell death. And it's also a very fun word to say, but essentially all babies are born with tons of neurons and tons of connections between said neurons, which makes them pretty sensitive to external stimuli. And that evolutionarily is good, considering that babies are potato humans who cannot do anything. So if they have super senses, they can notice a lot of changes in their environment, and then they're therefore less likely to get carried off by a large bird. But anyway, over time, as babies grow up, many useless neurons and neuronal connections are naturally pruned out to make room for more complex connections, now that survival is more guaranteed. That pruning is called apoptosis, and it gradually reduces the amount of sensory stimuli that people take in over time. And for autistic people, this pruning doesn't happen at the same rate, which means that we still have all the connections, which means that we're more likely to have synesthesia because that is an extra connection. And some scientists think that most babies are actually born with synesthesia, but that it gets pruned out by the time that they're old enough to express what connections they experience. In general, the data about synesthesia is a bit sketchy because it relies solely on people self-reporting, which means that they have to figure it out and believe it for themselves. And if your 6-year-old is telling you that the color blue smells like dirt, you'd probably say that they're just being silly, and over time they would stop believing it themselves. So it's probably a whole lot more common than we actually know at the moment. But anyway, my synesthesia is one of the rarer types. The most common type is grapheme color synesthesia, which is a natural association between written letters and numbers to colors. Other common ones include ordinal linguistic personification, which is associating fundamental personality traits to numbers, months, days of the week, etc. So this one could be cranky, or this one is a girl, etc. Chromesthesia, which is sound to color synesthesia, is also pretty common. Visuospatial synesthesia, which is seeing sequences such as numbers, letters, months, and dates as occupying points in space around them. And there's also ticker tape synesthesia, which is the automatic visualization of spoken words or thoughts, kind of like a teleprompter, but like in front of you. I don't know about you, but it's so cool what the mind can do. It's just incredible. Now, I cannot speak to those experiences because my synesthesia is not that, but in my experience, it can make things a lot more easily overloading because there is almost always an extra perceived sense at play on top of how sensitive I already am. But it can also have the opposite effect. My meltdown playlist is all songs that smell like sunshine and freshly cut grass, which promptly relaxes me. And I also have another playlist that smells like rain, which calms me down in a different way. And honestly, I don't know life without it, so I don't know how much it actually makes my experience of the world any harder or any different, because it just is. Anyway, I asked you all to give me some questions on Instagram about my synesthesia, and I chose a couple to answer. Also, if you are interested in me making some Spotify playlists, or rather, taking some I've already made on iTunes and put them onto Spotify based on smell for you all to listen to, let me know in the comments what you would like to hear. It may take me a bit to curate, but I do love making playlists, and I've been told that I am good at it. Maybe it's a smell thing, I don't know, but my current smell playlists I have personally are sunshine slash summer, rain, paint, camp, specifically like wood and trees and wood chips and stuff, fall, summer nights, vintage, which smells like hairspray but in a good way, and arts and crafts. But I am welcome to more ideas, and I can curate those playlists as well. I always love a good challenge. Also, I have never met a person who also smells sound, but I really want to, because then like we can compare our connections, maybe make a bigger playlist, or discover that our opinions are completely opposite, and it would be super super cool. So if you have this type, or you know somebody who does, please appear in the comments or message me on my social media. Also, if you don't follow me on the Instagram, I am the disabled autistic lesbian. Yeah. Okay, so Instagram questions. You all asked me some really good ones, which made me rethink the specifics of my associations and how the whole thing works. And it was a really great experience, so thank you. But anyway, first one, what are some of your favorite smelling musical chords? I'm gonna start with this one because it made me think a lot about what I do smell and what I don't. And I realized that it's timbre specific. So for non-musicians, timbre is the texture of the sound or voice. So like piano versus ukulele, for example, or your mom's voice versus your dad's. So it really, really depends. I've never really thought about specific musical elements before, so I can't quite answer this, but in regards to specific timbres that I like, my grandmother's voice smells like her house, which is a very cozy clean, and that makes me really happy. Also, ukuleles smell like sunshine and general green, and a good dissonant vocal cord smells like the music hall where I was trained when I was growing up. And yeah, that brings us on to our next question. Can you change the smell-sound association? Are they organic or can you force it? Now, in general, my associations are organic in the sense that I don't control when they happen, they simply just do. But as far as I can tell, very few of mine are random. They're just a smell from a specific time when that sound was happening that is just grouped together in the brain. So every time I rehear that specific sound, it triggers the smell and therefore the memory as well. And I once had somebody ask me if I could bottle a smell into a song, and I've actually kind of figured out how to do that. For anybody who knows me in real life, I listen to music almost all the time, and very often I will find a new song and I'll adore it, and then I will listen to it on repeat for like 2 to 3 days, and the general smell from that period will just glue itself to the song. And when I'm in a situation and there's music playing, I will Shazam every single song so that I can create a playlist to then recreate that memory in my mind if I so desire. And that used to just be a cool thing that I could do, but now that I have memory loss, it's actually the best way for me to hold on to memories I otherwise wouldn't be able to access. And smells only connect to a sound if there's intense repetition, or if it's the first time I've ever heard that smell, or if it's like a core memory. So sometimes they can change or they can combine. For example, I made a playlist that smelled like a specific event at my summer camp, and then I listened to it a lot late summer while driving with the windows down, and now it smells like a very nice combo of the two events. Also, they can change in context. I have some songs that are in several smell playlists because depending on which smells they're around, they can shift. And I can also manually change them as well, though it's quite the process. For example, there was this band that I was introduced to along with a couple other bands a while back that I really loved, and the person who introduced them to me, we always listened to that music together. And since I wanted to remember those times with them, I purposefully worked really, really hard to make a strong smell association between them and that music, which essentially meant that every time I listened to that band, when we were apart, I would smell them. And that was great, until the smell of that band and the other music they like began to trigger flashbacks and panic attacks, and we don't need to discuss all the things that happened between those two, you can use your imagination. But first of all, great band that I didn't want to lose, and second of all, not great to have songs that can just be played at some place in public and then me just immediately have a panic attack, because that's just not cute. So I clearly had to do something about it, and so I decided to create my absolute favorite sensory experience, which is swinging on the hammock in the sunshine, and then for weeks on end, I spent every single day out on the hammock all day just listening to this playlist on repeat. And now all of that music has switched to that smell, and it's gone from triggering meltdowns to being on my meltdown playlist to calm me down. And it was a long and exhausting process, but it was actually very successful. Not all the songs were able to switch over, frankly, because the more I listened to them, the more I didn't like them. So just don't play Lizzo around me. Specifically Good as Hell is just not a good idea. But anyway, that was a really long answer. I think it gives a good explanation of what I experience. Maybe? Moving on. Can you compare certain sound smells to known smells, or are they unique? As far as I can tell, they are all known smells because they seem to all be direct associations. There could be new smells mixed in and I simply don't know how to recognize or describe them. I don't know. Do similar sounds have similar smells? Because they're associations, yes and no. So people tend to curate playlists of similar music, so if we're listening to that playlist when it decides to imprint on my brain, yes, because all of those songs will smell like that situation, and then ones that sound similar will also as well. But on the other hand, as I mentioned earlier, I spent 7 years in choral training growing up, and a lot of choral songs sound very similar but can have different smells based on where I heard them the most, where I performed them, etc. One of my favorite composers is Dan Forrest, and I've performed his music in many different spaces, so his songs smell different based on where we performed it or practiced it or recorded it. My brain is weird. I don't know why it chooses to stick sometimes and then other times not. I don't know. But anyway, similar sounds can differ in smells or be similar. It can depend on the context, like the playlist that it's in, and the same sound can smell different depending on the playlist, as I mentioned earlier, or just the situation I heard it most or the memory that I have associated most strongly with it. What is the weirdest smell to sound connection you have? I'm so glad that somebody asked this because it is weird. It's really weird. So in a situation where somebody goes, "Hi, my name is Sydney. I'm a sophomore. I live in this dorm. I'm from Massachusetts and my favorite color is buttercup yellow," I instinctively smell spaghetti. And the reason behind that is because I went to a summer camp every year for 9 years, and we would do introductions on the first night every single session, which was 4 times a summer. And traditionally on the first night, the dining hall serves pasta because that's a safe food that most people like. So if anybody's feeling kind of homesick, at least they like the food, you know? So anyway, my brain decided to create an association between the two. And so now anytime anybody introduces themselves, I just smell pasta. And it's kind of an inside joke with myself, and every time it happens, I always smile. But now you know. I cannot trace specific reasons behind all of my associations, but many of them have very obvious origins, and this one is hilarious to me. It took me years to find out, and it's just really funny. What sound smells like vanilla, if there are any? I don't smell vanilla a lot in life, so I'm not quite sure, but I do always listen to the Great British Bake Off soundtrack when I'm baking, so that's probably the closest thing to vanilla. It usually smells like a mix between a lemony, vanilla-y cake batter and rain and oven heat, which is very pleasant. What does your favorite song smell like? For those of you who've ever had a conversation with me, you know that picking favorites really stresses me out because I feel bad for the ones that I don't pick. For some reason, a few things are okay to be favorites in my brain, like pasta shape or color, but also these can often shift depending on what my special interest is at the time. And the reason buttercup yellow became my favorite color is because I used to ask people all the time what their favorite color was, and people rarely said yellow, and then I felt bad for the color, so I picked it as my favorite, and then people started giving me yellow stuff, and now it actually is my favorite. And buttercup is the best shade. But anyway, that was a long way of explaining that I don't have a favorite song, but I'll list 10-ish songs that I like of late and their smells. Also, I might add that there are some songs that are objectively terrible that I really like, but I only like them because they have nice memories and smells associated with them, so please don't judge. Okay, here we go. Boys Like You by Dodie smells like the inside of your house when you're watching a fresh snowfall outside. Constellations by Jack Johnson smells like a warm summer night sitting on the grass looking at the stars. These are really specific. I'm sorry. Anyway, Colors by Black Pumas smells like rain, but like cold wintry rain, kind of, not like warm summer rain. The Dog Days Are Over by Florence and the Machine smells like sunscreen, but like in a good way. Grace Kelly by Mika smells like copper enameling powder and warm kiln. That one's specific. If you know, you know. Winter Winds by Mumford & Sons smells like warm car drives with the windows down in the early afternoon. So does Off She Goes by Bad Sons, but like that one's sunset time. Full Catastrophe by Somersault smells like sunshine and grass on the hammock. Fly Me to the Moon by Sinatra smells like hairspray, again, in a good and comforting way. The entire album Open Season by the Hi-Hi's smells like the dark room. Not like the chemical bits, but just like the general vibe. And Christmas Music smells like Christmas smells, so it is not to be played except exclusively in Christmas season, which does start after Thanksgiving. But anyway, those are all of your questions, I think. If you have any smell playlists you want to hear, drop them in the comments and go follow my Spotify to see when they show up. Anyway, thank you for listening. Thank you for learning. Remember that your story isn't over. It has only just begun. I hope you have a lovely rest of your day, and I will see you in the next one.